Takk skal dere ha. Jeg tror vi kan si etter de presentasjonene som har vært før i dag, så blir det «Now to something completely different». For nå skal vi snakke om, vi skal snakke litt om softwareutvikling, men vi skal snakke om det i kontekst av hardware, produktutvikling og hvordan det går inn i den litt mer grisete industrielle verden. Også tenkt å ta en litt annen tilnærming til det, for det har vært mye snakk om prosess og mennesker. Jeg har tenkt å ta den ingeniør-ufølsomme approachen, og rett og slett snakke om hvordan vi gjør det. Så vi har tenkt å dele foredraget her i tre deler omtrent, tror jeg. Jeg presenterer en problemstilling, 5-6 minutter oppstart. Så skal Leif her fortelle hvordan vi gjør det softwaremessig, hvordan Pragma har hjulpet Novelda med det, og så skal jeg fortelle til slutt 10 minutter omtrent om hvordan det integrerer inn i hardware-riket, og hvordan vi selger produkter til kunder som ikke er deployet og lastet ned fra webben, men som faktisk er noe fysisk du har i hånda, og det er et helt annet game. Ja, skal bare si 30 sekunder om Novelda. Novelda er et lite selskap i Norge. Vi er rundt 30 ansatte, kontor i Oslo, kontor i Trondheim. Har vært på, holdt på en stund egentlig med forskning og utvikling. Men for ca. 1,5 år siden så bestemte vi oss for at vi skulle bli et produktselskap og kommersialisere avansert teknologi. Selg det i millionantall til markedet og bli søkkrik. Det var jo den korte planen da. Jeg var en del av dem som skulle eksekvere den planen, så jeg begynte i Novelda for ca. Et år siden. Så det som jeg snakker om her i dag er det vi har gjort siste året egentlig på metodeutvikling da. Før det så jobbet jeg 14 år i Atmel og var ansvarlig for utviklingsplattformene for mikrokontrollere. Er det noen som har brukt Atmel Studio her? Der var det en, det er min skyld. Så jeg ledet den avdelingen i 14 år før jeg begynte i Novelda da. Så det er grunnen bakgrunnen min i industrien. Her er produktet vårt. Den er 64x42 mm, og det er en helt ny type sensor. Jeg må ta litt problemstilling først for at dere skal skjønne utfordringene av det vi har gjort etterpå. Den her er en helt unik sensor. Den kan gjøre mange ting. Den kan måle bevegelse, den kan måle presence, den kan se gjennom ting, den kan være adaptiv, den kan gjøre proximity, den kan brukes i husautomatisering for å se om det er folk i rom, hvor de er i rom. Den kan brukes til å måle kroppsparametre som pust og puls, masse forskjellige ting. Den er basert på ultrawide band radarprinsipp, hvor vi rett og slett sender et radarpulstog, veldig, veldig lav effekt, ingen som trenger å bli redd. Vi ligger under bakgrunnsstøyen i rommet, som en vanlig måleinstrument, så er du ikke i stand til å se det. Bare på grunn av korrelasjonsteknologi, så er vi i stand til å se retursignalet, så det er helt trygt i bruk. Med det så kan vi måle avstand til objekter, og vi kan måle bevegelse på objekter, og vi kan måle også hvordan objektene beveger seg selv, altså en pustbevegelse målt på brystkassen fra 3 meters avstand, som er pluss minus 1 millimeter, går helt fint å måle med den teknologien her. Så det er ganske unik i en del anvendelsesområder, egentlig. Bevegelse. Hvis vi setter opp flere, så kan vi også triangulere, og dermed gjøre tracking i antall dimensjoner som du setter opp sensorer. Vi har en del anvendelsesområder som er ganske fersk. Vi har det første opp her, jeg bare nevner, altså, for det det er et sånn type prosjekt som jeg tror bare går i USA. Det går ikke her. Her har de implementert radaren vår i et halsbånd for hundene. Det betyr at du kan gjøre biomonitorering av hunden din, så du kan se på pust og du kan se på puls. Du kan sample den mange ganger over dagen. Du har en nettside hvor du kan slå opp på din hunderase med alder for å se om man får nok næring, om man får nok trim, hvilken form er den. Du kan koble det opp mot veterinærfunksjonalitet. Så du kan, jeg mener, det er en service som 99% av verdens befolkning bare vil drømme om. Altså. De indikerer at det er rundt 1 million hunder i USA som har en sånn familietilknytning, og det markedet. Helt fantastisk. Jeg vet ikke om verden går fremover, men vi tjener i hvert fall litt penger på det. Så det går fremover for oss da. Ja, det er et teknisk problem med radar under vann, faktisk. Rice University har laget en fantastisk sak, du kan sjekke det opp på YouTube. De bruker mange av radaren våre, så du kan trekke 3D-bevegelse i rommet helt suverent. Vi har et ganske fint prosjekt, synes jeg, sammen med Samsung Thales, som går på å lage en minedetektor. Hvor de rett og slett har montert en hel haug av radaren våre på en bom. Radaren våre har penetrerende egenskaper, så den ser ned i bakken, og vi er i stand til å se også plastikkelementene ned i bakken. Så den prøver rett og slett å lage en minerydder som du bare kan kjøre, og som ser nedgravde miner. Så det er et litt årlig prosjekt, synes jeg. Flat Earth, et amerikansk selskap, har laget en snødybdesensor. Så i de skianleggene så preppes bakkene vitenskapelig, og du ser dybden på snøen mens du prepper. Vi har hatt veldig fokus på søvnmonitorering i det siste, rett og slett fordi vi har hatt noen store kundeleads som da går på, særlig innenfor fitnessmarkedet, folk skal jo være så trent. Og du kan monitorere alt mulig, en av de tingene som de da ønsker er å se rett og slett hvor godt du har sovet, du kan få en metrikk på det, du kan se din egen formutvikling. Dette har vi ganske stor interesse for i mange sammenhenger. Vi har også interesse for det i sammenheng med eldre care. Her et prøveoppsett, for vi har satt opp radaren vår. Og her ser vi har eksakt match med standard sykehusdata på polysomnografi. Da. Så vi er i stand til å måle akkurat det samme, ut fra det så kan vi gjøre søvnstegsanalyser. Så det er sånne ting vi driver på med å kommersielt jobbe med sensoren. Da. Sensoren ser omtrent sånn ut. Den har en sender og en mottaker antennepath. Den har en mikrokontroller og en del sånn leamik. Praksis så ser den sånn ut. Og en av de andre tingene, det må jeg bare si, altså, vi lager ikke bare den her, men vi lager også den ICN som er der. Den X2 radar System on a Ship-greia er utviklet i firmaet vårt. Og den har, tror jeg, verdens raskeste sampler i standard CMOS-teknologi. Den sampler på 40 gigabit. Den har vi patentert, så det er kult. Det betyr ultra-wideband-teknologien vi bruker går fra 6 til 10 GHz. Det betyr at vi kan sample direkte på bærebølge. Vi kan nedkonvertere uten tap. Vi har den cleaneste signalbehandlingen i bransjen, så det er veldig kult. Vi har, jeg skal ikke gå gjennom blokkdiagrammet. Vi har også en kompleks software som går på dette her. Vi bruker jo pulsdoppleradar, det er masse Fourier-transformer, veldig mye stygg matematikk, trekkere, adaptive trekkere, state combiners, det hele som da går med til å faktisk å skille ut den messige verden du er i, og få ut et fornuftig signal av det hele. Så problem statement, hvordan utvikler du det her i greien her, og hvordan får du produsert det, og hvordan får du det ut i markedet med rimelig kvalitet å bli trudd på når du er et så lite firma som oss. Vi har brukt, og nå kommer vi til dagens tekst da, DevOps. Og det ble sagt her før i dag fra dem som kom fra Finn at det var viktig å ha rett og slett hvorfor begynner du med det. Og for oss så er kvalitet en veldig vesentlig ting med DevOps-biten. Vi er en mygg, og vi prøver å selge til de. Oi, sånn. Sorry. Vi prøver å selge til de absolutt største selskapene i verden. Så spørsmålet er hvordan... Var det en feil? Nei. Så spørsmålet er hvordan skal vi bli trodd på at vi har produktkvalitet som er god nok? Og det kan vi gjøre ved å etablere automatiserte systemer som gjør at vi kan spore hardware-revisjon til serienummer på hvert eneste enhet vi selger, spore firmware-revisjoner til hver eneste enhet vi selger, spore kvalitetsprosessen til firmwaren til hver eneste enhet vi selger, selv om vi prøver å ha en relativt hyppig release-takt på softwaren. Så kvalitet er det absolutt viktigste for oss i denne settingen. Kompleksiteten er et problem. Vi har høykompleksitert hardware, software. Det skal ikke koste noe penger, for vi skal selge dem i millioner, og det skal være i forbrukerelektronikk. Vi skal selge dem i multiple konfigurasjoner, rett og slett fordi du får ikke betalt for software i dag i deltatt. Det er veldig vanskelig å få betalt for software, så vi må selge funksjonalitet til markedet. Vi skal ha distribuerte worldwide. Vi skal tilfredsstille kvalitetsrequirement til tier-end brands, og vi kan ikke gjøre rollbacks. Det er alt for dyrt, for da må vi ta igjen hardwaren. Så til motsetning til dem som deployer på webben og sier at nei, vi kan gjøre det om igjen, og stort sett går det bra. No chance, vi kan ikke gjøre det om igjen, vi må ha det ut rett. Så det var introen, så da kan du få lov til å fortelle hvordan vi gjør det.
Then I'm allowed to take over, so. And as it was stated, I think from Gunnar already from Capgemini, is that you have to know your goals before you start. The only problem with that can be that when you hear the goals, they want everything. Like they want time to market, they want quality, they want complete traceability, and of course it cannot cost too much because it's a small company. So that's what happens when you ask for the goal, you have to deliver all of it. So, which of course can be a challenge. I think some of the good thing in this case for us, we had some of the things that has also been mentioned previously as important. Management backup, like the company actually knew right from the beginning what they wanted, and there was backup for implementing this. We didn't have a big legacy, like neither in technical legacy or like people cultural legacy. So that was some of the things that actually makes this kind of things possible. even if it's still a challenge. So what's the solution to this? The solution is, even if this is a very different environment, it's embedded, it is industrial, the production environment is not a web server, it's actually like a SAP system that has to be produced or creating the specification for what has to be produced in Asia. But the solution is very much the same as we saw from Finn and some of the other ones. We really want like an integrated, automated pipeline going from developer commit to the production system, whatever that is then. So it's the same solution as we saw before. Some of the problems and challenges are different, but to a large extent, it's really very much the same. And we start out with what they started out everywhere else, I think, with continuous integration. We want to integrate. Every time developer do a commit, we want to integrate. I think the only step we might be going further than you do in some other places is that we actually have this as a gateway. If it doesn't like build and build and execute the unit test, we actually reject it. So we have that automated as well. You cannot disturb your colleagues. Like if it's not good enough to be integrated with the colleagues, sorry, you're out. You have to try again. Otherwise, it's like the normal step in that situation. Oops, that was the wrong way. But we want to do a lot more than continuous integration. We really want to do continuous delivery, like until at least we have what we call a release candidate, something that's good enough to go into production. And that's the rest of this pipeline. We want to do analysis metrics on the code. There's actually a lot of tools you can use for doing static code analysis and investigate your code and the stuff you have done, if it's the quality you want to do. We put a lot of effort into that. After that, you want to do functional tests. That means you have to deploy into some kind of test environment or place where you can test your things, and you have to run a lot of functional tests. That has to be automated as well. Of course, that is then different in a hardware setup. We can actually generate a lot of documentation and things like that. And then the last one is the validate. We actually differentiate a lot between software verification and validation. Like verification is checking that it's doing what the requirement is doing. Validating is basically checking that it's doing what the customer wants and needs. That can be really, really hard to automate, as I think they also mentioned before in the previous presentation. So that is a place where we typically will have some kind of like manual intervention. Like, is it really doing what the customer wants? That validation can be hard to automate or impossible to automate. And then, of course, we put these two things into an automated pipeline, and we have it when we are through with the validation for something that has been produced. We actually say that's a release candidate. That's something that's good enough to put into production. It was also mentioned in the previous one that having good version control system is very important in this. I completely agree. Not just the version control system, but actually also like your strategy for how you use it. Like if you want to do parallel development, if you want to do a lot of development, you want to ensure that that is being treated well, you really have to have a proper strategy for your branching and the way you work with it. This is like the one we have been using. I won't go into detail, but like the release train, basically ensuring that we're always working on this next release train that we are working on. Automated testing is very different in this environment because you cannot just like deploy it to a web server and test it. This is actually a Lego robot. I think that like your ways actually go through the Lego.
So yes, we use Lego Mindstorm for all our test environments. It's perfect for the use. It never breaks down. So we have highly skilled and paid engineers playing with Lego during the work hours. So that was the advertisement for taking a job.
Exactly. That's actually a very serious job benefit. So. So Dag also mentioned like the complete traceability of the versions and whatever is being produced and delivered to production in different ways. That has also been automated in this with the automatic generation of the versioning numbers from the build systems and the version files. So that's also a very, very important part of the solution. Then the package delivered like from the build system. One thing is that we have to deliver the firmware that actually has to be produced and then put into the chip. But we also have to deliver test suites to the manufacturer so they can test the things, and that also has to be reproducible so we know exactly what was delivered and exactly how it was tested. All that is actually packaged into together so we can deliver it together, and we have complete traceability of what we deliver to different test stations, which is also a very important part of the solution. The hardware process is also, like normally that's considered a very waterfall method. You don't want to make mistakes, so you really try to check the things before you actually start developing and things like that. But a big part of this development and creating prototypes and testing and verifying things, even in the ASICS development, you can actually implement with a similar pipeline, which we have also done for the ASICS development. The way you test it in your simulated environment, things like that, like the underlying tools are very different, but the process and the way you do it is very similar to in other, all other kinds of environments. And then at the end, we put it all together. It's all being run by Jenkins. We have our test plans, a lot of information coming out of SAP. We generate it and put it into Artifactory repository, so it's ready to be sent to the manufacturers if it has to be produced. We can actually automate the distribution to different test stations so we can test the things using Puppet. So that is the automated process that we have set up. And again, within like a year from we started this. I think that was the last of my slides.
That was good, that was good. So, operations. Operations in this term deals also with quite a few other things. I mean, when you're a company like ours, this is the interfaces that you need in order to do such a product development and get it into the market. So we work together with Cadence for the EDA tool chain that we use for all the synthesis of the ICs that we develop. We use TSMC, it's the world's largest IC foundry in Taiwan for making the wafers for the chip. We use ASE in Korea and other places to do bonding and packaging. We do tests of the ICs at Delta in Denmark. We do PCBs in China at a company called Sumtech. We do PCBA and box build at a company in Malaysia. We do logistics absolutely everywhere. We do excess material handling in Hong Kong. We do waste management, waste material handling everywhere. And we do have a warehouse in Malaysia, or we're setting up a warehouse in Malaysia. So this is the infrastructure that you need in order to actually kick off a product product like this if you're going to be big and do it worldwide. And all this also need to some extent need to be integrated with the product development, or at least it should. If you look at it when we start manufacturing things, this is the first of two slides that actually shows that. And the whole software development at this time is reduced to a component name. It's just a component. Anybody here knows SAP? Enterprise Resource Planning System. Some people like it, but then they're weird, and most people hate it, and then they're normal. It's the program that controls everything in your company. It controls logistics, it controls all material handling, it controls orders, everything. So it basically it links together the business side of the company, but it also links the engineering side of the product development into the release process. And that is what I'm going to show over the next slides. So basically at this stage, we have the software that is going to be used at a test station that contains all the software for the product release as a component. And we do have our own SAP system where we actually build, let me see if that is the next slide, I'll skip to this. For each product, we build what's called a hierarchical bill of materials. It contains everything. It contains build instructions, it contains the reference for the PCB, for all the components, but also for the software that runs on the unit itself, the bootloader, the software that runs in the test station, everything is contained in that bill of material. And what happens is that when we want to build something at the factory in Malaysia, we send a production order to that factory in Malaysia stating that we would like to build this item number, and that is the top level of the hierarchical bill of material. So everything is defined by that bill of material. Then they copy that bill of material into their own SAP system, which they use for purchasing all the components, which has an average lead time in the world market of between 8 and 12 weeks. So we better plan in advance. Then they set it up for surface mounting, they pick and place, stage it, you do reflow soldering, you do automated optical inspection, you do serial number generation. This is important because then you actually get a, you get an ID on each thing that you manufacture. And then you send it through what's called manufacturing defect analysis, which is basically analyzing the build quality of the board before you turn power on it. And then you do the final PCBA test in a test station. In the final test station, you just put the board, you scan it. And what happens when you scan it is that it looks up the article number, which is the top level bill of material. Then it goes all the way back to the Artifactory, which was the output of the continuous build process from the software development. Because now it knows which Artifactory entry to actually pick out, and it checks if it has the relevant software on the deployment station. So by this mechanism, you ensure that you automatically always manufacture with the right firmware on the board and the right setup for the test station. And then you also store back the test results on the test station. And what you do measure in the test station is, are all the voltages correct? Are all the radar signals correct? And so forth. How are we doing with time? Not too bad. 4 minutes? 4 minutes? Yeah. So now we have identified the, now we have an ID on each unit and we have the test results. Then it goes through the rest of the stage. We pack it, we ship it to the warehouse, picking customer orders, again through SAP article numbers, go into the entry, we pack it, we transport it, and we have a happy customer receiving a quality product at the end of the stage. Yoo-hoo! So what I wanted to show here really is that how the particular, how the software flow integrates into the hardware build mechanisms and how the different pieces actually fit together, or how it can be done at least. Mm-hmm. Some conclusion. Continuous delivery. It delivers the promise of quality and available software. And if you do it right from the start, you definitely get there faster. I spent more time in my previous job doing setting up the system than I did in this job. So it goes with practice. You can do it faster. It does not have to distract the teams significantly. Actually, when you do automate a lot of the tasks, as many previous people have said here today also, it's a benefit because developers do not like to do repetitive tasks. They like to do new tasks. And if you automate away all the repetitive ones, they're usually quite happy with that, and there's little resistance to doing it that way. Setting up a complete shop like this for a company of 30 employees that does the hardware development, software development, everything, it's actually, it's difficult to grasp all the technologies required. When you're larger, when you can have distinct support team doing it, it's easier. I would say in that particular respect, the market is still not as mature as it should be on the tool side, in my opinion. At least it is a hassle for smaller companies to actually grasp all the technologies. Fortunately for Pragma, that's what they live from. So they did an excellent job in this example. So I mean, you can buy yourself support, but it is a mouthful to actually start out. And also, I think as a side comment, I don't think the methods that we are discussing here today is very much embraced. I continue the English.
Yeah.
After you, okay. I notice now. It's not very much embraced by the academic community. What's your experience with that? I mean, I think the curriculums that are taught at the universities, students that come out are pretty blank on these things. Any comments from the audience on that? You agree? Okay, good. Yeah. Yeah, but still, if you want to do it, you can do it. And I think what we have achieved here in 12 months' time is actually quite good.